For some reason, analog video got my interest a while ago. Something about the technology of it and the historical and almost nostalgic components of it. I got some CRT TVs and even assembled an analog transmitter. But there's something really cool that I want to do with analog video. I want to add closed captions. I know that sounds kind of boring, but the way it happens is really cool. This near century old technology was able to carry text and other data in sync with the video. The big thing is that it's completely optional to the viewer. You don't have to see any of this data that's being transmitted. You can choose to show captions, but you don't have to. How can you have all this within an analog video signal? I'm not going to dive in much on the topic because it's out of the scope for this video, but I suggest you check out some other videos on how it works. It basically boils down to this. Analog video is made up of a bunch of lines, 525 in the United States, and there's actually some extra lines on the top and bottom of the video that are just black, which hopefully this demonstration is making clear. The TV uses this to synchronize and stuff. With all this unused space, why not put it to work? What if we digitally encoded closed captions and sent them as pulses of light on a certain line? In the 70s, it was decided that this was what was going to happen, and the FCC reserved line 21 of analog video for closed captions. I'll actually show you what this looks like. If I mess with the vertical sync on my little Sony Watchman, you can actually see the extra black space along with those pulses of light. This is that digitally encoded closed captions information. I found all this really interesting when watching some videos from, again, Technology Connections, which, if you find any of this interesting, I highly suggest you check out the videos on closed captions. I even made my own video on closed captions, because for some reason I love them. For a while I was looking for a way to make my own captions on analog video. Not for any practical reason, just because it's really cool. I was thinking I might have to build some sort of device that can lock onto the signal and inject the captions. There was another way I was considering, using a hack RF, which is basically a little transmitter, and it would transmit a TV signal with the closed captions. A viewer suggested this, and it might actually work. The only thing is that the hack RF costs a good amount of money, and I would have to write my own code to get it to have the captions. While it's an option, it seemed like a lot of work. Now keep in mind, this was years ago. Since then, I put together that little analog TV transmitter. I still couldn't find an easy way to get captions on it. But then one night, I searched again and found a Reddit post linking to an eBay listing. It was a caption encoder for TV, and it was only $20. I bought it and waited. After impatiently waiting for it to get to my house, it finally arrived. So I don't have the best video of me turning it on for the first time. It was packaged really well though, and was in good, clean condition, so I had high hopes. I set it up with my analog video going into the box, and all it said was video missing. I messed around in the menus, looked online, then reread the label. It just said digital caption encoder. The title of the listing was the 8084 AD model, but this was just the plain 8084. I was pretty bummed. I just bought something that is completely useless to me, but I was able to get my money back for it. That still left me captionless. So I went back to eBay, and somehow I found a listing for the AD model. It cost a little more, a lot more, by like $50, but I got it anyway. So for the second time, I waited for it to arrive. Luckily, it shipped faster, and after unboxing it, I got it hooked up. I think it's time for a proper introduction for this box. This is the Evertz 8084 AD, an analog and digital closed caption encoder, supporting line 21 analog captions with up to 4 caption channels and 4 teletext channels. On the back, it has 3 DB9 serial ports for up to 3 different computers, or daisy chaining different encoders, modems for sending captions over the phone line, analog and digital inputs and outputs, a parallel port, and optional dual power supply. Getting the video hooked up was pretty easy. It only has BNC jacks on the back, but I had these BNC to RCA adapters that let me hook it up. It uses the same signal, just a different connector. The input signal obviously goes into the input port, but there are 2 output ports. The preview port is just for seeing what captions are being sent. It actually just burns them into the video, like open captions would be. In your studio, you can see what captions are being sent out on just like a regular broadcast monitor. But the bypass out is what we want. This will be the original video signal, unmodified, except for line 21 where closed captions are encoded. It's called bypass because there's actually a relay inside that closes when the unit is unplugged or loses power. This bridges the input and output together, which bypasses all the encoding hardware. If it loses power, the video still gets passed through without captions, basically like the encoder isn't part of the chain. If it didn't have this, you would literally just see a black screen or no signal if the power was out. In a real broadcast environment, that's the last thing you want. Now that the input is hooked up and I plugged a bypass port into the TV, I plugged in power for the unit. After its little startup sequence, you can see the image flicker for a second as it clicks over that bypass relay, but it still said video missing. I was disappointed. This one should have worked, but for some reason it was having trouble finding a video signal. Luckily, after poking around in the menus, I got it to work. So now that I was able to detect a signal, now what? Nothing's showing on the TV. It looks exactly the same as what's coming into the TV. So in the menus, there's a test message you can send out, which is basically just to make sure, without a computer needed, that the encoder is plugged in correctly. So I turned that on, but nothing was showing up on the TV. I grabbed the remote and pressed the captions button on it, and it said it was listening in on channel 1 for captions. There are multiple channels for different languages or stuff like that. And nothing was showing up. I went to go double check everything and troubleshoot it, and just as the first caption out of this encoder popped up on the screen, I blocked it. But look at that, it's the next one. So yeah, the box is encoding on line 21, closed captions, and my TV on the other end is decoding them and putting them on the screen. Now I want to put my own captions on the screen. That's one thing the initial Reddit post warned about, that getting software for this might be difficult. First, I just hooked it up to my computer using a USB to serial adapter and plugged a serial cable into port A, and that was the easy part. Now to find the software. The only mention of this encoder on the Evertz website is the manual. I'm glad they're at least hosting that because it makes it significantly easier. There's still no official product page. So I found a newer encoder on their website and looked at the URL. The end is literally just the product name, this one being the HD9084. So I replaced that with 8084AD, the model number of the encoder, and no luck. But there's always the Internet Archive. I pasted that URL into the Wayback Machine and was so happy to see an archive of the 8084AD's product page. It was saved in 2006 and had all the right info and specs. The only thing I'm looking for on here is the software, and right at the top is CaptionWare, the software for it. When you click on the link, it takes you to another archive page, which talks about the software a little and has some screenshots, and now that sweet, sweet download link. It says we can download the 30-day free trial, and somehow the .exe file is either still hosted on their website or got archived. So I downloaded that, and I'll show you the screen recording of that now. Okay, so now we're ready to go over the software. I'm going to be using Windows XP for this because why not? So here it is. Just going to double click, and this is really just your basic install shield app install. Choose the location to install, and there you go. So let's open it up. All right, so the first thing you're greeted with is this pop-up that just sets up some default information for it. So network name. I'm just going to put YouTube. You would put the actual name of your network on there. Call letters is like your call sign or whatever. Since I'm West, I'm going to put K at the beginning and then IDK because I don't know what to put here. And then the TSID, which I think they call this the transmission ID. I think it's just like an FCC identifier. You're going to put 1. And then the same, we're currently using the trial version of the software and that's going to expire in 30 days. All good. And now we're in the software. From what I can tell, you wouldn't actually use this as your main software. You would have actual captioning software that hooks up to this, but this is more just for configuration and testing it. So I'm gonna go over here to plant options. And for this is if you wanna, like, you see the send configuration button. You can set the time on here, or you can change your call sign or whatever, and then you send the configuration over. I'm not gonna bother with that. VChip is digital. I'm not gonna be using it because it only works on digital, but it is cool. You can go enable control and set the name of the show. So let's just say it's news at 10, and then you can set the rating for it. So you can choose a standard. We're gonna use US TV because it's TV. MPA would be for movies. And then you can choose any of these. So none would just be like not rated, which most news would be.
but you can go up to like TV-14 and let's say for violence and language. So this is how stations actually put that information in the TV signal. Now caption channels, this is the cool one where we're gonna actually send some captions out. So here's a little test box just so you can test it, and then some other settings. Decoder settings is for the built-in decoder, which outputs over that second output port. And again, that's just for your studio preview. You can choose which one it decodes and shows. You would only have this in the studio just to make sure your captions are looking good on other TVs. I'm not gonna bother with that, but here's a test one. So we're gonna send our first caption out, and of course we're doing Hello World, and we're gonna make sure the channel is on CC1, and then I'll put up a camera of the TV. The camera isn't showing the screen on the caption decoder very well. I don't know why that is, but everything else should be okay. So we're gonna do CC1 and press send. And it looks like I forgot to actually connect to the encoder. So I'm plugged in with serial to port A. And when it says, would you like to attempt to connect now? I'm gonna just press no and go to setup here and port settings. And now I'm actually gonna set up the port. So we're on COM1. And in the settings, I set the encoder to be 9600. Parity, I set to none. And data bits, I set to 8.
I'm not too worried about these settings. They were kind of chosen randomly. The encoder doesn't even need that much speed. Apparently, lower baud rates work just fine.
Okay, pressed OK, and now let's do connect. And you can see down here, it says connected, and connected to Evertz 8084AD on port A. So now, when we go send here, nothing happened, and that's because this is closed captions. The TV has to decode it and put it on the screen. So I'm gonna go in the settings real quick and enable captions. Okay, let's do it again. And look at that, our first caption. You can see a couple of lights on the encoder light up, and then that caption right there is displayed by the TV. The actual video signal doesn't have the text drawn. It's just the black and white like flashing lines that are on line 21. And the TV's decoding it and putting it on the screen. So if we can spam click it. Yeah, it's pretty cool. Now if we change it to CC2 or whatever, these are the different channels for captions. Press send and nothing happens on the TV because it's only decoding caption channel 1. So you could have different languages or whatever if you wanted. T1 is for teletext. So if I set my TV over to teletext, you can see it just displays a black box on there. And I recommend you look into teletext on your own. I never got to use it, but it was a way of sending news and other information like traffic or weather over text over the TV channels. So if you were watching a show and you wanted to just see some headlines, you could click it and you could see a decent amount of information on it. They even made logos out of text, which is pretty cool. If I just send it, and I can keep clicking and it just keeps adding text to the end of that. You can see as I spam click it, the text just keeps scrolling up. So you could have information slowly go out line by line, and I think you can even do color, which is cool, and you get up to 4 channels on that one.
From what I can tell, web TV is a way of pulling a bunch of text and putting it on teletext channel 2, and articles is a way of sending a bunch of texts to the encoder that can be sent out of a text channel. It actually stores it on the encoder itself, not your computer. I'm not going to be looking into this too much in this video, maybe another time.
CC looping is a way of just displaying a text file over and over again. So if I make a new text file here, there's not really a lot. You just put in the text, but you can specify like the delay between lines being sent. So the syntax for that is // and then line delay equals, and let's say 3. So 3 seconds between lines. And you can also specify the channel that you want those captions to be sent on. So // CC channel 1, like that. And now you can just paste in whatever you want. I'm just going to paste in some captions from an older YouTube video. This is, you can see it actually tried to do some of the formatting there. This is from the clear phone video. And if I save it, now if we go back to the software, press browse, and let's go to the desktop and loop. And you can see it put in the closed caption delay and the delay after each line. Now we set the time we wanted to loop. I just chose continuous loop and start looping. And now we gotta change our TV back to actual closed captions. And there we go.
CGMS is actually really cool. It's a form of copy protection for analog video. It's not like macrovision, which really messes with the sync and color of the video when you're trying to copy it. It's basically a little flag that gets put in that unused space, and it tells digital recorders to not allow copying of the media. If it's present, it just won't record. Pretty easy to bypass if you have like a weird cracked digital recorder or any analog recorder.
So that's pretty much it for the software. They have some decent guides here, which is just the basics. You can see the screenshots actually Windows XP, which is part of the reason why I wanted to use XP, but that's about it.
Okay, so that was the CaptionWare software. Unfortunately, I can't seem to find any other software that works with this. I'll keep looking for the software. Worst case scenario, I should still be able to send data over that serial port. I'm still learning how to use the commands, but once I get that working, I'll upload a video on that. Anyway, that's about it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it and maybe even learned something. Thanks for watching.